Hello, everybody, and welcome back once again to a Friday edition of Inside the Headset. I'm here with the head coach of the Blackman Blaze, head coach David Watson. Coach, last Friday night, you went off first in the Jamboree at two quarters, and talk a little bit about it to the fans and everybody, a little bit about it, the Jamboree, and what you got out of it, and then what you didn't like about it, or how it helped you get to this point and where we are moving into tomorrow afternoon.
Well, you know, I was pretty pleased with our effort. I thought we gave great effort. I thought we had pretty good intensity. I thought we learned some things about ourselves in terms of substitution patterns and kids adjusting. I think, you know, we didn't prep for the Jamboree. We talked about that last week. We didn't prep for it very much at all. And it really showed defensively more than it did offensively, because Stewart's Creek runs a defense that's very similar to ours. So we were kind of ready for that offensively. But their offense is a little different than what we do, wing tee, and we didn't really do a great job early on of recognizing what they were doing, and they were able to move the football on us some, you know, and score a touchdown and a long drive there. I was really kind of disappointed that we didn't make some plays when we had chances to get off the field, and more so than that, I didn't really feel like our kids at times adjusted from the sideline. You know, once we got coached up on the sideline.
I noticed that.
You know, I wanted them to, you know, we don't have a lot of kids that play both ways. We have a few that cross over, but most, 90% of our kids play on one side of the ball, so we're able to get them off the field when the offense is on the field, the defense can meet, and kind of get some things adjusted to what you're seeing. And I didn't feel like we did a great job of taking to that and going back out there and eliminating some mistakes that we made on the first drive. That was the most displeasing thing. But other than that, I was pleased. I thought Miller was solid. I thought Taylor Dowdy was outstanding running the football. We really expect some really
got
great
that additional yards after, you know, he gets touched. They're trying to bring him down, and he falls forward.
Right. And Taylor's got great speed. He's explosive. Master Teague did a good job coming in and running, because we weren't going to play a Taylor and Miller a great deal. They both got two series. And then once those two series were over, you know, they were coming out of the game no matter what the score was. If we were up by 14, down by 14, whatever the situation was.
That was already scripted.
Right, I was gonna limit those kids. And I wanted to make sure that Connor Mitchell got some reps at quarterback, because before the year's over, Connor's gonna have to play some quarterback for us, because Miller will get dinged, or Miller will, you know, something will happen where we'll need Connor. So Connor needed that game experience, because from this point forward, we're not going to have the opportunity to get him a lot of game experience unless we have an injury or something that we hope we don't have. So,
and you don't want him playing any. If you do want him going in, you want him playing quality minutes. I don't mean a mop-up game or anything.
Right.
You know, that's not quality, but you want him playing with your onesies.
Right. Get him in there behind the first-string line, and still have some good receivers in the game that can do some things, some experienced receivers that can do some things. And so we saw some things from that. You know, overall, lack of preparation, they're going to score. We moved the football fine with our ones. We did have a turnover. Then when we subbed out, it got a little sloppy, which I think is the case in most situations. So my biggest disappointment was adjust a little better, you know, adjust and fix some things.
You think it was the highs and lows that they were having a little problem getting adjusted, because it was only for two quarters and maybe it was just going to be a quick flash on the field? I felt like, you know.
Yeah. I mean, four series is what we got.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, you know, by the time you get out there and get warmed up and get a little bit of the kids,
and you're trying to play everybody or play as many as you can. When you have 115 like we do, you can't play everybody in two quarters, but you still want to try to play as many as you can. And, never really felt like we got in a good flow. And then, of course, when they move the football on you, the kids are going to have a certain amount of frustration that you've got to kind of calm them down and get them back focused. But, you know, I think Stewart's Creek's improved. I think I think that they've got a good, solid football team. They're physical, and they executed what they did. So
and their fans love them.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And well, that's important.
And it was good for, you know, it was good situation overall for us. And we saw some things wing tee, because we'll see some wing tees later the year. So we'll be able to take this film and show the kids and reiterate some things that we didn't do against them, and move on. You know, we've moved on from it, because it was just. It was a Jamboree.
Yeah, it's a quick practice. Like you say, it's just a trial run. So since then, you've been working on Chalkville, you've been working on Chalkville, you've been working on Clay Chalkville. Tell us a little bit about these guys. I mean, you know, let's dial in a little bit deeper, although I kind of spilled the beans. You know, they're 18th in the nation, but got some guys that are going to be playing on Saturday on TV, on the SEC Network, if they go ahead and pan on out. But, you know, to everybody, I mean, the kind of talent they're going to bring in, are they a passing team? Are they a running team? What's their philosophy?
Well, you know, one thing that's unique and a little unnerving is this. Alabama has different scrimmage rules than Tennessee.
Okay.
So they started later than us.
Okay.
So they've only been out there probably 2.5 weeks.
Wow.
And they haven't scrimmaged yet this fall. Mm. This is the week that you can scrimmage, but they're playing us. So we don't have any film on them this year's team.
Right.
We did in the offseason swap 4 films of us last year for 4 films of them last year.
Just to get an idea what you got.
So, you know, they are a team that throws the football. They'll run it some. It's a little bit confusing because last year their best tailback, who's now MTSU playing football, he tore his ACL, I believe, or had a significant knee injury right around the time they started the playoffs. So I'm sure they got away from their philosophy a little bit because of injury.
Lost their gun.
But they've got an outstanding quarterback. He had 60 touchdowns last year running and passing. I believe they scored over 700 points in 15 games. So they averaged right at 48 a game on offense.
Is it up tempo?
Yeah, I believe it's up. From what we can tell, it's, you know, they're getting on the line, calling plays off what they see you, how you line up. So I don't know how fast they are. We'll figure their tempo out Saturday, but they're on the line pretty quickly. You know, figuring out what you're doing, calling plays off of it. They got 2 outstanding wide receivers. One's committed to Alabama. The other one's got offers. He's an underclassman. He's a junior. Their quarterback's got several SEC offers. I believe Missouri's offered him. I know Middle's recruiting him. So they've got great offensive weapons. You know, they've got real good size out there at wide receiver. They're tall, 1.65. I think the other one's 6'2". So, you know, they're very well coached. I've had a lot of conversations with Coach Hood. He's a great guy. They 2-platoon their football team, so they have an offensive unit and a defensive unit. You can look at them on film and their blocking schemes and their technique that their offensive line use on pass protections. You can tell they're coached up. They're well coached. Their passing concepts are very, very good, sophisticated. Defensively, they run a 4-man front, and they're multiple out of that. I know that they're a big 7-on-7 team. They've done all that. They just have a really solid football program. I mean,
so fans are going to get to see, you know, what one of these things look like. You know, that next level, so to speak.
Right. You know, 6A state champs last year, arguably. You know, when we were down there playing Hoover, I know the talk was who's better, Hoover or Clay at that time, because Hoover's 7A, Clay is 6A. A lot of people in Alabama think 6A is the most difficult region or
level
or classification. Because just through reading things on the internet about that, they talk about the depth of 6A and how good it is. So they're a great football team. There's no question. When we played Hoover last year, I thought Hoover had great class and the way they ran their program.
It.
Alabama, and you know, from all my conversations with Coach Hood, they seem to be the same type of program. You know, it's a class program. They're organized. They got good support. Their community will travel well. So, you know, it's exciting. You know, of course, you would like to not open up with someone that good, but it is what it is. It's where we're at. It's where our program is.
And then, you know what? It's never a good time, Coach. You get into Game 4 and you come off, well, we just come off River. That game will never work in, will it?
Absolutely.
You don't want it to come at the last of the season either.
Right. But, it, you know, it's a positive. We're going to go compete.
Yeah.
I feel like we're prepared. The kids are. We've gradually built some momentum this week. I thought the weather hampered us early in the week. We had a great day of preparation yesterday. We'll have a great day today. Tomorrow will be exciting. It'll be fun to play on the turf at MTSU. Big crowd, I hope. I mean, I think it's just tons of positives. But we're going to go compete, and we're going to see where we're at. I mean, I think we're ready. I think we're prepared. I know our kids will play hard. I know they'll play physical. So it's going to be exciting.
If not, they're going to learn something. They're going to learn, if they don't come out with a W, they're going to learn a little bit about playing at the big level, prepared, and just going through all the motions. Because part of this is the journey, the win and the loss. One of you's going to win, one of you's going to lose. But the journey is about, right, a little bit about it.
We want to be better tomorrow than we were Friday.
Regardless.
And the same thing next week. We want to be better then. This, you know, with the new classification, the way it's set up, this is no longer, we're a tournament sport. It's not, we're not fighting for the playoffs. We're in the playoffs.
Yeah.
We're fighting to peak at the right time. We're fighting to get better each week, to stay healthy. And we want to be good 9, 10, 11. We want to be good all year. Don't get me wrong. And we're going to be a good football team.
You want to be striding just like an NCAA basketball team. Right. When you hit that tournament, you want to be rolling. Yeah.
That's what's going to matter. And it's truly a marathon, not a sprint.
You played a lot. Pass here. If they talk to the fans and just even to the normal everybody else, what it's like. I mean, how did you prepare years ago and get ready for a big game like this? You know, when you were in the mode, when you was at this mode back when David played, what was you thinking? Or
I just tried to, I tried to just mentally go through little things that I would study, you know, about as an offensive lineman, just different fronts, watch some video, and then after a certain point, I would try to shut the video down and stop analyzing. And at that point, just mentally get myself ready to play with some excitement, with some juice, you know, get myself mentally worked up to have that passion.
Was it music or what? I mean, what did you?
Well, back then we had Walkmans. We had Walkmans, and I guess it was probably a little music. It's been so long ago. I remember, I think, when I moved from cassette tapes to CDs, that was pretty big. But it was music, and just you had a little ritual where, you know, in college they'll deliver a big stack of programs to the locker room, and you go walk the field and kind of get acclimated to the surroundings, come back in, go find a spot somewhere, read through the program with your headphones in, and then try to build yourself up to being ready to go at whatever time you were kicking off. But, you know, I see kids do that a lot nowadays. They're all different.
Yeah.
Some want to be by themselves. Some want to be reading something. Some want to be playing around and be loose. You know, they're just all different personalities and things like that.
Well, so you felt good about everything leading up to this point, about where you are and everything. Let's just walk through tomorrow. Of course, you're going to do your walkthrough tonight, but preparing for a 4 o'clock game. Kids get in here, what, 11, 12, have lunch?
We're going to pregame meal at 12. We're going to try to leave here around 1, 1:15.
Yeah.
Get over to the middle. We want to go on the field somewhere around 2:40, 2:50.
Okay.
Be off the field around 3:30. So we want to get over there about an hour before that happens, just so we can walk the field, come back to the locker room, take our time getting dressed, and then get out on the field. I don't believe in a big, long warm-up. I don't want to be out there forever. I want to get out there, get loose, get acclimated, get back in, get your face wiped down, get a last drink in you, and hear the national anthem, and then go play.
How much preparation as far as I was listening to the game last night, and they were talking, you know, a lot of cramps and stuff. How much preparation have you done, Coach?
Well, we talk about hydration. You know, that's one thing, and we've conditioned.
Right.
We try to tail that off a little bit toward the end of the week because you want to be fresh.
Yeah.
You don't want to overdo it. We'll hydrate them today after practice and talk about that. And then we'll have some stuff set up tomorrow when they arrive here to get hydrated.
But just curiosity, average kid, just normal bottles of Gatorade, how many of those things do you need into before you head out on a 4 o'clock
game? Talk about water, you know, water.
So it's not Gatorade, you know, you're educating.
It's a little Gatorade, but more water than anything. It just seems like that's the best thing. It's so pure, and I just think they constantly need to be drinking.
Okay. So it's just, there's no limit, just as much as you can hold.
Right.
You know, I mean, just keep, if you can keep swallowing, keep drinking.
Yep, just keep sipping on some water.
Anything else to the fans and everything? I know the band and everybody will be present and all the Black New Faith will be out. Just anything before we go into the first one?
Well, I just think, you know, this is a great deal for our community.
It really is. I mean, I'm glad for John Jones.
John Jones has done a great job. Craig Sewell's been heavily involved with helping kind of co-chair that. We've had parents. Oakland's had parents. We started meeting on this. I can remember the very first meeting was back in March. I was still the interim head coach at the time, and we met with the Chamber of Commerce over right down the road from here, over on Medical Center. And there's been so many people that's had to do things, and John and Craig have done a great deal. There's no question, and it's been a learning experience because there's been things that pop up like, do we take our goalpost or does goalpost pads or does MTSU supply that? You know,
just little things that you don't think of.
All kinds of things that you don't consider that you have to think of. And John's done a great job of getting sponsorships, and he's really spearheaded it. It's a big thing for our community. I think this raises Murfreesboro football.
Absolutely.
I've been here. I played at Central Middle School, played at Oakland High School, played at MTSU, and I've coached. I can't recall a doubleheader before, you know, with
much energy like it is today.
With two Murfreesboro teams. So, you know, there's going to be a doubleheader there. You're going to have our community. Hopefully people in the mid-state will be coming in. It's good for MTSU.
I think Coach McDaniel might make the trip.
Right. It's going to be exciting. We're fortunate to be a part of the first one. I think all the schools will be a part of it. This is going to be a thing that revolves around and it can involve the other schools. So we're really fortunate to be in the first one. But, you know, I just think people need to come out, be a part of it.
Absolutely.
Support their kids. You know, that's one thing I talk to our parents about is the best way you can support your kid is being involved in something. Because once they're out of high school, your involvement's going to be less and less. And this is a chance for you to kind of tag along and make some memories with them.
Heck yeah.
It'll be real exciting, and you know, I'm proud for our community to be able to host something like this, and I know that everything's going to go well, and we're going to do a great job with it.
All right, tomorrow afternoon at 4 o'clock over Floyd Stadium, it'll be the Chalkville team coming in to take on the Blackman Blaze. Y'all be there.